Hi and welcome. I recently got this EGA card that I wanted to try out. It is a late, highly integrated Super EGA card made by Everex Systems. But EGA cards are not compatible with a VGA monitor. They use a 9-pin connector that carries a signal that is incompatible with VGA. EGA cards require an EGA compatible TTL monitor, which is really hard to come by, so I need some kind of adapter. There are already several great projects that convert these types of signals to something more modern, like VGA. MCE to VGA is a great example, but I wanted something more DIY and more hacky. I was inspired by Necrowares and the Rasterize videos about their DIY adapters. In their videos, they explained how they designed adapters that convert the TTL signals coming from an MDA, CGA or EGA card to analog VGA, almost. They achieve that in totally different ways. One uses a programmable GAL chip and the other uses an EEPROM. Both are great projects, but the downside is that they are meant to be connected to an RGBS upscaler, not directly to a common VGA monitor. Necrowares adapter has the option of producing a VGA-style RGBHV signal that has separate horizontal and vertical sync signals as opposed to the composite sync in RGBS. However, it won't work in most modern VGA monitors. The reason is that the adapter does not change the timings of the horizontal and vertical sync signals. So the horizontal sync in the output is 15 kHz, just like the input, therefore requiring a 15 kHz capable monitor. Such monitors do exist, and there are several websites with resources on how to find one, like 15kHz.wikidot.com, but they are not super common. So the common alternative is to connect these adapters to an RGBS upscaler and connect the output of the upscaler to the VGA monitor. But please note that cheap upscalers like the GBS8200 need to be modded to work with non-15kHz EGA modes. So I wanted to come up with a simple adapter that works on all VGA monitors without an upscaler. Having been tinkering with a Raspberry Pi Pico recently, I thought that this is a perfect opportunity to try building one using the Pico. And I'm going to call the adapter MC Blaster. But before I show you what I made, let's take a step back and go over the problem that we're trying to solve. Let's focus on the input. I will use the EGA signal as an example, but CGA and MDA or Hercules are quite similar. An EGA card produces a digital TTL RGB video signal. It has two bits for each of the basic colors, red, green and blue. One bit is the primary color bit, and the other one is the secondary, or intensity bit. So if we set the primary red bit to 1, and all the rest to 0, we get the color red. But if we also set the secondary red, green and blue bits to 1, we get bright red. The Wikipedia page on the EGA adapter includes some very nice tables that show how the EGA color palette corresponds to the RGB bits. CGA and MDA work in a very similar way, but they use fewer bits. CGA uses the same 3 primary color bits, but only a single secondary intensity bit that is shared across all colors. And MDA or Hercules uses a single primary color pin and a single intensity bit. A good thing is that the pinout is somewhat compatible across these 3 standards. So building an adapter that handles EGA requires only small changes to support the other modes too. Now let's consider the output. VGA is analog. It uses 3 RGB pins with a voltage range of 0 to 0.7 volts. So to convert the digital RGB color signal to analog, we just need to convert the digital value of each color to an analog voltage level. For example, in EGA, the color red uses the value 10 in its red channel, which is 2/3 of the way to the maximum value. So the VGA red pin should have a value of 0.7 volts times 2/3 equals 0.46 volts. Converting all 3 color channels from digital to analog will give us a VGA compatible analog signal of the same color as the EGA digital signal. The conversion circuit is actually fairly simple and requires just 2 resistors. It is known in the literature as an R2R resistor ladder. Now let's calculate what resistor values we need. The VGA monitor terminates the RGB pins internally with a 70 ohm pull-down resistor. You can check this yourself by measuring the resistance between any of the RGB pins to ground with a multimeter. Mine shows around 75.5 ohms at the VGA connector, which includes the resistance of the cable itself. The maximum voltage at the VGA pin at the highest color intensity should be 0.7 volts. And this should happen when both red pins at the pico are high, that is 3.3 volts. The circuit forms a voltage divider with the combined R2R resistors at the top section and the 75 ohm resistor at the bottom. If we do the calculations, we get that the combined R2R resistor is 279 ohms. Given that R and 2R are in parallel, the combined value is R times 2R divided by R plus 2R. Solving for R, we get 419 ohms. It is safe to use higher resistor values, but they will produce a darker video signal. Okay, now that we know how to convert the color signals, let's focus on the horizontal and vertical sync signals. These are digital TTL signals in both EGA and VGA. Their job is to guide the electron beam in CRT monitors, and they provide the timings for traversing the lines and frames. The horizontal sync pulse instructs the beam to switch to the next line, and the vertical sync pulse instructs it to move from the bottom of the screen to the top. As the electron beam moves across the screen, the intensity of the red, green, and blue parts of the beam change to make up the colored pixels. In all MDA, CGA, and EGA, the horizontal sync is between 15 kHz and 21 kHz, meaning that each line takes between 66 and 47 microseconds to draw, including the black borders. But most VGA monitors draw the lines much faster and won't work with horizontal sync lower than 31 kHz. So the problem that the adapter needs to solve is that the input RGB pixel data comes in at a different rate than what we want in the output. So simply converting the RGB signals to analog while using the same horizontal and vertical sync produces a signal that most VGA monitors cannot process, as it is just too slow. This is the reason why Necroware's adapter requires a 15 kHz capable monitor or an upscaler. To solve this timing incompatibility between input and output, we need some buffering. The input pixel values need to be stored in memory, and the output signals should be created from scratch using the buffered pixel values. The Pico has 256 kilobytes of RAM, which is just enough for the EGA 640x350 mode, assuming 8 bits per pixel. So the firmware running on the Pico does the following. Each TTL input pixel is read by a PIO state machine in a cycle-accurate way. Then the pixels are received by the first core and are written to the buffer in memory. The second core is doing the reverse. It reads the pixels from the buffer and forwards them to the PIO state machine, which outputs them to the VGA pins one pixel at a time with the correct timing. The horizontal and vertical sync values are computed by the core and are passed along with the pixel values to the PIO. The only issue is that the Pico cores are not fast enough for this simple forwarding task, even after optimizing the firmware code by transferring multiple pixels at a time and offloading the brown color correction and the border detection routines to PIOs, it was still not fast enough. So I had to overclock it to 270 MHz to get a stable image. The circuit is actually pretty simple. The only other major component is a level shifter for converting 5V TTL to 3.3V for the Pico's GPIOs. Let's try it out in EGA 720x350. When there is no signal, we get this really nice splash screen. Let's run check it video tests. Most of them work okay. Except mode 6 hex, which is monochrome 640x200. I need to investigate why it's not working. There are two issues that need to be fixed. The most obvious one is the occasional vertical flickering. This happens when the Pico increases the line count by 2 instead of 1 when it detects a horizontal sync pulse. The second one is the repeating vertical aliasing bands, which are due to the sampling frequency of the Pico not matching exactly the pixel frequency. I will try to fix both issues before the first release of the project. Now let's try Monkey Island. The picture is not centered. Pressing the auto adjust button will automatically center it just right. The vertical banding is very visible. Other than that, it doesn't look too bad. Now let's try the original Quest for Glory, which looks really nice in EGA. Anyway, that's all for now. I will be working on fixing the remaining issues of the MC Blaster, so please stay tuned for a follow-up video. And as always, thank you for watching and goodbye!